Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. My dear respected listeners, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Saffiya Maryam, and you are joining me today for the Secrets from the Seerah series, inshallah, that we're going to be covering throughout the month of Ramadan. Hope, inshallah, everybody's fast is going well and that everybody's in the Ramadan spirit. You know, we're right at the beginning. Yet, and inshallah, the enthusiasm and the passion and the iman boost that I'm sure everybody is feeling, hopefully we can maintain that all the way throughout and beyond the month of Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. And she obviously provided such a good childhood experience for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we as parents or as siblings or as aunties and uncles, we really should try and embody that as well. So the certain traditions that tell us regarding the time that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with Halima and how delightful she was, and how the whole of her household, even they were favored by like amazing things that used to happen to them, like good fortune, you can say, whilst this little baby, this little toddler, this young child Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was under their care. For example, the way that it started, she herself, she narrates that it was a year of drought and famine. So she was going, she and her household, etc., the whole tribe, they were going through a period of drought and famine, and there was pretty much nothing to eat at that time. This is how bad things were. So she rode on a donkey. And even then, it was a donkey that was very, very frail and old, and they had a camel with them, again very, very old and frail, so much so that it wasn't capable of even giving milk. This is how, obviously, if you're going through a famine and a drought, you can imagine the humans have nothing to eat, let alone the animals. So she says that the children were crying all night because of hunger. There was nothing. And what kind of scenario would that be? And subhanAllah, every time you hear stories like this, every time we see videos, hear accounts of what is happening around the world still today, you know, that people are still dying of malnutrition, of poverty, of starvation, of thirst. You know, subhanAllah, we live in a world where there is so much wealth, but it's so unevenly distributed. That is the problem, that you can't fathom that in the 21st century there is still famine afflicting millions of people around the globe. But it does happen. And we can't, most of us, I'm guessing, don't know what it feels like to be in a state of extreme, extreme poverty, so much so that we don't know where our next meal is coming from, or we are so under malnutritioned that our bodies are frail and we are weak, and our children are crying because we don't have enough to feed them. SubhanAllah, what kind of a test this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So especially in this blessed month of Ramadan, please do take the time and the opportunity, and it really is an opportunity for ourselves, not for the people that we are giving to, but rather we ourselves are more in need of it, more in need of giving charity than the people that we are giving charity to. You know, it might seem like kind of counterintuitive perhaps, because there's somebody starving out there, the money that we give might, it's going to help them, it's going to alleviate their suffering, even if it is for a short time. So in our mind, we're kind of thinking that we're doing them a favor. But even though we might be doing them a favor, you know, on the outside, it looks like that we are doing them a favor in this dunya. But when we see the reward of these acts of giving and charity in the akhirah, we will recognize then, we will definitely acknowledge then, that by Allah, it was them that was doing us a favor by giving us the opportunity to give. So when we give, we are giving for the sake of Allah. We are giving, in order to procure Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and pleasure, because these are people who are, beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. they are our Muslim brothers and sisters around the world, so we should try and do whatever we can, especially in the month of Ramadan, and not limited to the month of Ramadan. You know, this is it's not really the correct mentality to have, where people never ever give outside the month of Ramadan and then in Ramadan they start giving. And in some ways, you know, mashallah, it's great that people have this, you know, special connection with the month of Ramadan, and people recognize how powerful, important, and special it is. And we do exert ourselves in this month, and that is all well and good. But let's not forget that the 11 months of the year also belong to Allah. That in the 11 months of the year, there are people who are still suffering and starving, are in need of our care. So let's begin in this month a little bit of charity every single day. There's so many charities out there, you know, it's very easy to find somebody that is raising money, and you can go through the projects that are close to your heart, etc., and give a little bit every single day. You know, don't let a day go by in Ramadan, even if it's 50p that you can afford, even if it's £5, if it's £50, £100, from whatever Allah has given you, give something, but give it consistently with the intention of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So going back to the narration of Halima, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that on this particular day, it was a year of drought and famine, and there was not enough food for the children, and they're crying all night because of hunger, and there wasn't, she didn't have enough to eat. So obviously when you don't have enough to eat, your body is not producing any milk, so she wasn't even able to breastfeed the children as well. And she says that we used to constantly pray for rain and relief, of course, constantly pray for rain and relief, because whenever we are in a difficulty, that is what we do. We call out to Allah to alleviate our pain and our suffering. So she says that after some time we reached a Mecca and we were looking for children to suckle. So she was a wet nurse. This was, you can say, her job, her profession. So they've come to Mecca and they're looking for children who perhaps want to be suckled. And she says, not a single woman amongst us accepted the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam offered to her, because as soon as they found out that he was an orphan, they refused him. You know, subhanallah, because the understanding was that an orphan child, you know, if the father has passed away, how are they going to pay for the services of a wet nurse? So all of these wet nurses that are coming, they are, subhanallah, refusing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because by looking at his situation, they think that because he doesn't have a father, then we're not going to get any sort of wage or any reward or compensation for suckling him. And in hindsight, you know, for us, there's so many lessons to kind of derive from this. Subhanallah, that by looking at the outward, there is so much that we are missing. You know, isn't that true? And this happens all the time. You know, you meet people for the first time and you get this impression of them, but little do you know what the reality of them is. Little do you know what they actually are like behind closed doors, and how they're like with their family and friends, etc. And that doesn't just go for strangers. Think about people that you've known your entire life, you know, your best friend, for example, or your cousin, your relatives. Even then, we don't know the reality of people. We don't know what their relationship with Allah is like. We don't know when they go home, how they behave with their parents and their spouses and their children, etc. So the outward appearance is always deceiving. Sometimes we look at a person's situation and it looks like they don't have enough money, or they're not very well educated, and we're constantly making assumptions. We're constantly jumping to conclusions. And in the same way, you know, these wet nurses of the time, they were looking at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he wasn't a prophet then, but they were looking at the outward exterior, that this is an orphan child that has nobody, therefore he won't be able to benefit us. But subhanallah, look how Allah teaches us and taught them as well, that those people that have nobody in this dunya, they definitely have Allah. Those orphan children who don't have anybody to look after them and to care them, and the fact that they are orphans, society shuns them and thinks nothing of them. But look how Allah elevates their status, elevates them to such a degree that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was destined to be an orphan. And Allah says in Surah Duha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes reference to how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an orphan and how Allah took care of him, that he might not have had a father, but he might have not had a mother because she passed away when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very young as well. But still, this young boy was destined to become the leader of humanity. He was given the opportunities which obviously nobody else before him and after him could have afforded. So she mentions that because the Prophet ﷺ didn't have a father, a lot of the wet nurses were refusing him. So every woman that came with me found a child to suckle, except for Halima. So she goes, when we were about to depart, I said to my husband that, look, I don't want to go back without a baby. You know, everybody else, all of the other women have found someone that they're going to be taking back, and I don't want to go empty-handed. What do you think about that orphan? I feel that I should go and I should take him. And so the husband says, look, there's no harm in doing so. And even though we thought before that no good could come out of an orphan child, perhaps Allah might give us blessing through him. So, you know, again, this was through the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now Halima and her husband, they are making this plan, making this intention that we are going to take this child. So they went and they took the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They went and when Halima Sa'diya, she lifted him for the first times, he was lifted up to the breast of Halima Sa'diya. And even though, remember, the previous night and all of those days, she wasn't able to feed her children because her body was so weak that she wasn't producing milk. But this was the first, you know, miracle that manifested itself, the first inkling that they had of the barakah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was to bring into their life. And she goes, as soon as I lifted him up, I found to my great surprise that I had enough milk, and he drank to his heart's content. And then even Halima Sa'diya's own children, they drank as well. And even though they had not been able to the previous night. And then, subhanAllah, lo and behold, the husband goes out to the camel that they bought and finds that the camel is ready to give milk as well. So they milk the camel and there was plenty of milk, etc. So this again, it just gives us a little insight into how the blessings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they began even before he was born. And the mother of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his grandfather and Halima Sa'diya and all of these wet nurses that suckled him, they saw that even before prophethood, this was a child who was not an ordinary child. He was a very special child indeed. He was the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so with him, you know, so much good fortune and barakah came the way of anybody who associated and affiliated themselves with him as well. So I'm going to stop there. That was just a little kind of a few notes from the early life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the really take home messages that I wanted us to focus on today was, number one, the importance that we should be giving as a community. So definitely as parents, because Allah has given us a great blessing and a great responsibility through the form of our children, and it is our job and our duty, our responsibility to do that to the best of our ability,
we shouldn't be neglectful of this great blessing and this duty, and whatever it takes, we should make sure that we are fulfilling our obligation. We have no control over, you know, the life of this child. We don't know this little baby that we've had or this child that we are raising, what they are destined to be or to become. We don't know what's going to happen, you know, in the future. We don't know whether this is the person that is going to be, you know, close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We pray that they are. We don't know if they are destined for Jannah or if they are not. We are not in charge of anybody's guidance, not even our own children. We are not in charge. Guidance only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But our job as parents is that we fulfill our responsibility to the best of our ability, because we're going to be asked about our efforts. We're not going to be asked about the outcome of what this child ends up doing and becoming, but we're going to be asked whether this flock that we had under our care, whether we looked after them and we cared for them and we taught them to the best of our ability. And that is so important, not just to focus on the outward, not just to focus on the materialistic side. And obviously as parents, I'm sure everybody knows that we're always, always thinking about what to buy them, the clothes, the nappies, then the food, and you know, one outfit and then another outfit and then the shoes and then the toys, and making sure that they have the best of what we can offer them in terms of a materialistic sense. And we do that, and alhamdulillah, may Allah put barakah in all of the money that we spend upon our children and our family, because that is a good thing to do within bounds, as long as we're not being extravagant. But we, the halal money that we earn, we should be spending it on our family. If there is any good and benefit that we find, then we should do so. However, we shouldn't neglect the education and the nurturing side of it, because it's not just a physical nurturing that children require. You can ask anybody who has lived in a life of opulence and luxury, and there are many examples out there of people who have everything in terms of a worldly sense. They've got all of the money and they can buy whatever they want. They never have to think about finances and expenses, but that's at the expense of time that is spent with family and the children. And children don't want money and toys and things being thrown at them. What they crave more than anything is the time and the attention from their parents, from their loved ones, from the family around them. That is far more valuable. So we have to maintain a healthy balance and make sure that we are spending time and giving attention, raising our children to be happy more than anything else, to be happy and confident young Muslims. Focusing on their education as well from an early age. It is our job, not just when we, you know, send them off to school and maktab and masjid, etc., and expect somebody else to teach them about the foundations of their deen. You know, we are really missing out on a gold mine if that's the mentality that we have. We should be the ones that are teaching our children from a young age about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about La ilaha illallah, about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about the Salah, about Surah Fatiha, about Surah Ikhlas and Falaq and Nas, and all of these things that are going to stay with the child for the rest of their life, inshallah. You are setting the foundations of their relationship with Allah, and you are teaching them things like Surah Fatiha, for example, that they are going to be using and reading and reciting, inshallah, every single day for the rest of their life. So you want to be the one that teaches them. You want to be the one that gets that reward every single time they are praying. That reward comes back to you. So from a young age, we invest in our children and we do what is best for them. And we see this from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the custom of the Arabs at that time was that in order to give the child the best possible start, they used to send them out into the desert to live with the Bedouin so that their language could become perfected, so that they were raised in an unpolluted environment, their bodies could be strong and healthy as well. And the second lesson to take away today is how the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like his grandfather, like his uncle as well, how they took care of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the death of the father, and then after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's mother as well. He was taken under the care of his grandfather, then after the grandfather passed away, under the care of his uncle. Now, these two individuals, they completely doted on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They treated him with so much love, so much care, so much compassion. In fact, they used to favor the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even above their own children. They looked after him and they gave him everything that a child possibly could want. And of course, there's no replacement for a mother and a father. Of course, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was still, he was an orphan child, but they took him in, and this is, you know, his dad's dad and then his dad's brother. They took him in and treated him literally like one of their own. They stuck by him. They gave him an excellent upbringing. And even in our lives today, we have to make sure that often there's loads of family disputes and politics that really mess with the lives of children. We have to make sure that children are far away from any dispute and politics that are in our homes or with our relatives, etc. Of course, we should be trying to make amends and maintain ties of kinship. But there's always situations in every family where somebody doesn't get on with somebody and, you know, all of the drama that ensues. But children do not need to be a part of any of that. Children, you know, every single family member, whether it's from the mom's side, whether it's from the dad's side, whether it's an uncle, whether it's an auntie, whether it's a grandparent, whoever it is, this child that has, you know, been blessed, that you have been blessed by having them in your family, they are a gift from Allah. Therefore, everyone collectively has now a role to play in raising this child. So you should be good to the children. And I've seen in so many scenarios where grandparents favor one grandchild over another, or they, if they like one parent, if they like the mother, then they'll be good to the child, or if they don't like the mother or the father, then they treat them differently. You know, this is wrong. And we see even from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his grandfather and uncle, you know, this was before Islam we're talking about. You know, they didn't have Iman and they didn't have Islam inside of them the way that, alhamdulillah, we do. But they had good mannerisms. They had a good understanding of what family is. And they looked after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They looked after this orphan child and gave him the best possible start that they could. So we also, when it comes to our own family, alhamdulillah, when it comes to our siblings and our children and our nieces and nephews, we make sure that we are contributing positively to their upbringing, and we're not doing anything to kind of jeopardize that. You know, make sure that you're not the, you know, the naughty aunt or the uncle that's always teaching the children bad things, etc. You don't want to be that. If you've got a child in your life that Allah has blessed you with, in whatever relationship you have with them, try and teach them good things. Try and be there for them. Try and be a good role model for them, inshallah ta'ala. So, because we are running out of time now, we're going to stop there. Inshallah, join me next week where we're going to move on to the early life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, looking at his job, looking at his marriage, etc., and seeing what lessons we can derive from there. So in the meantime, in this blessed month of Ramadan. Please do keep myself, Saffiya Maryam, and my family, my teachers in your du'as. Make du'a for the whole of the Muslim Ummah. Make du'a for the people who are working behind the scenes for this radio station as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept everybody's efforts. And like I said at the beginning, please do try and go above and beyond this Ramadan. Learn about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These sessions are just to give you a little taster. There are so many excellent resources out there, excellent scholars on YouTube, on the internet, etc., that are delivering sessions about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the more you learn, the more you will most definitely fall in love with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the easier it will be for us to implement those traits into our life and into the lives of our children, inshallah. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakumullah khairan for listening. If anybody wants to get in contact with me or has any questions or suggestions, you can always reach out to me on social media. My name is Saffiya Dash Maryam on Facebook and Instagram, or you can always contact the radio station and pass on a message, inshallah. So until next week, please take care of yourself. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.